I can't think of an issue that needs more attention around the world, particularly when we're talking about driving the fundamental challenges that continue to plague societies around that undermine liberties, than the importance of reasserting the primacy of property rights as part of the human rights discussion in the interests of everybody. And I, as Human Rights Commissioner, made that one of my priorities on appointment, and have continued to progress that discussion as much as anything else as part of our broad discussion around basic rights and liberties in 21st century Australia, but also across the world. And the way we've done that is by looking at the broader discussion around human rights and fitting it within that context of basic rights of the individual, and then looking at opportunities to discuss the importance of property rights generally, but trying to anchor it in a discussion that people understand, and particularly to highlight the human consequences that occur when property rights are denied. And of course, that is nowhere clearer than in the situation of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, who have a common law title of land, which fundamentally gives them very few rights to allow them to economically develop their title and improve their human condition. And that has obviously direct human consequences in terms of their wealth, their opportunity to enjoy higher standards of living, but also undermines the potential to get jobs and everything else that flows from it. But one of the key debates that I've had to have is the importance of property rights as part of that human rights discussion. And I find it very odd that it even needs to be asserted, though I'm sure many of the people in this room would take exactly the same attitude, because I fondly remind people that if you take the international treaty aspect of human rights, Article 17 of the Universal Declaration said that everyone has the right to own property alone as well as in association with others, and that nobody should be arbitrarily deprived of their property. That basic theme has been lost by many of human rights activists, as I would argue too many people these days confuse human rights with issues of social justice, and as a consequence, property, rather than being seen an advancement of human rights and underpinning the rights of the individual and a reflection of people's earned labour, is becoming an issue or seen as a barrier because it's seen as a form of unjust takings by private individuals rather than being seen as the benefit that it provides to society overall. And of course, the root and the contribution of private property has a long history in terms of the relationship of the Magna Carta, where there was that great charter of 1215 established the very clear principle that a person's property can't simply be seized without some form of compensation. We have a similar reflection in our Australian Constitution around takings by the government. It has a long entrenched relevance in classical liberal political philosophy, where we saw people like John Locke cultivate the simple idea that property rights are part of the human rights discussion, because in his second treatise, Locke argued that the moral case everybody and every man has over his property and his person and the labour of his body and the work of his hands, may we say, are property his. And that from that, people get to value add their contributions to the earth and enjoy a higher standard of living. And that the direct denial of property is akin to denying someone the reward for their labours. And when you actually have a system of title that doesn't exist, you, of course, see the consequences of that. And that has been a work of exploration by such key thinkers, of course, as the Peruvian economist Hernando de Soto, who demonstrated the harsh consequences of what can occur when property rights are absent in his groundbreaking book, The Mystery of Capital, and of course much of his subsequent work, that property rights actually have a critical basis in terms of economic development, particularly when it's tied with other things like finance, to enable people to achieve a higher standard of living. So in Australia, we have a very significant challenge where Indigenous people over 200 years have been denied access to their land and as a consequence of European settlement. During that process, there has been continual efforts to secure that land by Aboriginal activists, looking at opportunities through courts and legal processes to have full recognition of their traditional lands. In the 1970s, there was significant progress towards establishing a title in some parts of our country under a Land Rights Act. But in terms of other lands existing in our states, and it's part of our federalist structure, the same principles did not exist with the same degree of flexibility. And it wasn't until the 1990s, through a significant case in the equivalent of our Supreme Court, the High Court, that recognised a form of common law native title that gave back Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people control of their land, at least at a superficial level, that they were able to secure some form of title. But since then, both through a legislative process as well as through courts, there's been a diminishing in the role and importance of that title to the point where it really is a superficial right. It has no significant capacity to be used and utilised for economic development. It has an enduring cultural value. It has an enduring contribution towards Aboriginal heritage, and that is the superficial right that exists above it. But when you go to the capacity for it to be used for purposes of economic development, it's not so straightforward. The law doesn't simply allow it, and equally cultural values that sit behind Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people's attitudes towards their land, particularly around collective governance arrangements, means that you have a situation where land is not fully utilised. So as Human Rights Commissioner, one of my key tasks is working with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities to seek constructive reform that recognises and respects the enduring cultural connection that they have to their land, but also to enable it as a key contribution towards their economic development. And that requires taking them as much as anything else on a journey, because after a long period of land rights battles, understandably, they're very wary of the risks that can occur when you have a form of title and expose it to using, as say, for instance, the basis of security for raising finance and capital so that they're able to achieve development. In the past, they've avoided those risks by simply bringing in external parties, particularly through mining interests and the like, who develop their land in their place, which means they're able to preserve title and create revenue streams, but it doesn't mean that they are in the same position to be able to do what they want with their land. And in fact, you know, in terms of law and practice, it's actually easier for somebody like myself to develop their land than it is for them as individual people. So there's a really significant need to have a discussion about how they're able to do that. And at the start of this year, we had a big meeting in Broome, which is in the northwest of our country, in May, that brought together the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander leadership of Australia to start that conversation. And it's been a very interesting conversation that we've had, because what Indigenous leaders have consistently raised with us is, I would argue, a very clear parallel between the issues they face and a broad libertarian philosophy, particularly around issues of excessive regulation that undermine their self-determination and actually amounts to entrenching poverty, because they are not able to do what they land in the same way that exists with statutory titles, such as the one that sits and underpins the title on my own home, or any other type of ordinary property that exists in Australia. We also have significant challenges around taxation arrangements that impose huge bills on them for land that they've never had the opportunity to develop. And to put that into perspective, if you haven't been able to develop your land over a period of 200 years, yet you're expected to immediately meet the financial cost of 21st century taxation and regulation, it has a fundamentally deleterious impact. And that's particularly important in terms of environmental regulation. In the northern part of our country, at a place called Cape York in the great state of Queensland, there have been significant overlays that have been put, environmental overlays over people's land, which has basically meant they're not able to use it for any sort of extractive industries or primary industries, particularly in the forestry sector, for where it is very rich. So the opportunity to be able to use that land natural assets to achieve economic development is significantly curtailed in a way that somebody like myself or the rest of Australia has not had the same restrictions over a long period of time. And that, of course, has the direct impact of undermining their right to development. But there are still also significant legal restrictions that stop land being used as the basis of equity to raise the capital to be entrepreneurial. And it often astonishes me how much people like myself and others in Australian society need to be reminded how much of our economic development is underpinned by the capacity to use that basic form as title as a basis to raise capital, and from there to be able to use it to invest in their future and create new opportunities. So in our significant meeting in May in Broome, we brought together Indigenous leaders to talk about how we start to resolve some of these fundamental challenges, looking at the importance of flexible legal instruments to enable communities to use their title as they see fit, including with different ownership structures that also meet their needs. The need also to develop complementary new business models that ensure finance can be raised and that risk can be priced so communities can build their economic opportunities and fundamentally integrate them in the rest of the market economy in a way that they're currently denied. It's essentially an issue of unequal access to capitalism and mechanisms to raise finance for the development of housing and ownership. Because not only through the collective arrangements are people denied the opportunity to be able to raise finance, but also to be able to access the basic security necessary to then go on to build private homes and ownership. And from there, of course, it doesn't just undermine them in a collective sense, it also undermines them in an individual sense. That, of course, opens up a huge Pandora of cultural attitudes that need to be discussed and recognised amongst Indigenous communities, because in the past, their attachment, rightly so, has been to a sense of collective identity and also survivalism that comes from collective identity about the preservation of their culture and their heritage and their way of life prior to white settlement of this country. So what we've started isn't just a conversation amongst Indigenous leaderships about the importance of the issues that sit outside of them and are regulated by government, but also started a conversation within Indigenous communities about how they're going to manage their collective affairs in the future, particularly how we recognise the need for individual entrepreneurialism in the framework of collective governance discussions, and how that then has an onflow effect around pricing risk and dealing with the various challenges that exist when you're working with other parties, say, for instance, financial institutions that want to be able to lend capital to be able to develop their land, particularly where it has particular value. And I say particular value because it's not just in the desert. In many cases, you have title sitting across some of the most beautiful beaches in our country, which are ripe for opportunities for ecotourism, well, tourism generally, but of course, the narrative is culturally sensitive and environmentally sensitive tourism to create opportunities for employment and development across Australia's Indigenous communities. There's also, of course, a huge potential in many rural and regional and remote communities to develop opportunities for mining and extractive industries, as well as many other sectors such as agriculture. When we started this conversation, there was, of course, a significant buy-in of Indigenous communities because they became acutely aware of how much the denial of the freedom to exercise their property rights was undermining the potential of their own communities. But it now deeply allies very closely with the objectives of our own government, because as a nation, it's becoming increasingly aware that the role and the title holdings of Indigenous communities is so large that it has a direct financial and economic impact on the rest of our nation. And if we want to see the sort of industries that can grow and create the opportunities for the next generation of Australians, whether Indigenous or not, we need to take advantage of our natural assets. Now, that runs into enormous challenges domestically with environmental groups and various other groups who often want to see Indigenous communities preserved in what they would argue is their natural habitat and their natural culture and natural attitudes. And that is part of the discussion that we need to keep driving forward, because it is not acceptable for Indigenous communities to be held against their will in a time warp of economic poverty because it suits the interests of wealthy people in capital cities. There has to be a process of reform which recognises their ambition to realise their dreams, and a process of reform that supports that but built on a full integration into a market economy. And that is where we're working as the Human Rights Commission, as Human Rights Commissioner, in partnership with Indigenous communities to not just advance the contribution of property rights, but the role of Indigenous people in part of the market economy to achieve their better aspirations. And I think we're going to be a much better nation for it.